Marty Kihn from Gartner, and he's going to do the intros on the panel. Come on out.
Welcome. Thanks, John.
All right, good to see you.
You too.
Thanks. Pleasure. Michael? Hello.
Hello. Have a seat. How's everybody? So I'm Marty Kihn. I work at Gartner. I am also the basis for a character on the show House of Lies named Marty Kihn. This is a true story. I don't know how many more seasons I'll be able to say that. Season 4 this year, Sunday nights. So I'll just stop there. We have a distinguished panel, some of whom may or may not have television shows based on them. I'll let them introduce themselves. We have someone from a market service provider, a brand, and then a SaaS platform. So just tell people who you are, how you fit in the attribution media mix, marketing mix modeling space, and also who you're wearing.
Exactly. There you go. Exactly.
Well, I'm wearing Bernie's Mountain Dogs, by the way.
That works. I'm John Vane. I'm the CEO of a company called MarketShare, and we fit in those two spaces. We're the only company that actually, with a single framework, helps make decisions at the very strategic marketing mix level as well as the attribution level. And trying to compete with Mike Lazaro on the Sox front, so we'll take votes afterwards to see who won.
Well played.
There you go.
Hi, everybody. I'm Michael Wexler. I work at Citi. I run digital analytics and using data to optimize marketing experiences. So I'm the client buying all these wonderful products and services and trying to figure out what to do with them.
And I'm Sunny Youn. I'm a digital media analytics director at Epsilon. There is a show called It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia, but hopefully that's not based on my life. But essentially, so for those of you who don't know, Epsilon is the online solutions group for alliance data, which has its roots in the traditional CRM and direct response marketing side of the house. And with the online solutions piece, we put together closed loop analysis for first party and third party data to help get a truer picture of online media attribution.
Okay, well, let me start with the obvious question. So if we live in a world where half of marketers, according to our study, do like some form of last click attribution, let me ask you, John, what's wrong with that, and why should we care?
I think what's wrong with it, when I sort of zoom out on what we do, I think of our 500 employees, we have sort of 50 PhDs, and which is nice, but I think that when people come to you with solutions, if they don't comport with your gut, I don't care how smart their people are, it probably doesn't make sense. Darwin probably took care of getting you all into the positions of your companies that you have a gut and intuition of what works. So when you talk about last click, you could think of the analogy like soccer. You know, very often whoever scores the goal does not have anything, you know, is the least important in the trail to get there. Conversely, just because somebody doesn't click doesn't mean that there wasn't a value in the ad, and that's, I think, one of the major flaws with kind of the traditional attribution players out there, where they don't take into account the brand value. If you see a TV ad, you don't click on it, but that doesn't mean it doesn't have a persistence and help influence your decisions.
So basically, if you're doing last click analysis attribution, it's inaccurate.
If I could use my 1,000 words or your one word, yes, it's inaccurate.
Sonny, let me ask you this. So the title of this thing is Attribution and Marketing Mix Modeling, the Colliding Worlds. What is the difference between attribution and media and marketing mix modeling, and why are they colliding?
Well, I think that we've seen in this conference the last 2 days that we've moved from pixel-based marketing to people-based marketing. And really what that means is that in the past, it used to be a treasure hunt for cookie pools, but we've seen that that's no longer the case any longer. It's not enough to go after audience selection based on past behavior, and there's really an opportunity to use the marketing mix modeling side of the house, which is going after acquisition, customer retention, and loyalty, and combining that with the ad tech side of the house, which is combining the media campaigns and measuring that properly.
So, Michael, let me ask you this as a brand. What is the benefit of going through this exercise? Because I've heard rumors that it's extremely complex. I mean, we're talking about online and offline. We're talking about trying to get into people's minds, understand influence on perception. talking about different channels, there's email, there's this, there's that. It seems really complicated.
You mean painful?
And painful and expensive, shall we say. So what is the point of even going through this exercise? What do you get out at the end of it?
If you believe that last click is inaccurate, then what you're really saying is I'm willing to spend millions and potentially hundreds of millions of dollars in a budget on stuff that isn't right. And so after a while, you sort of have to explain to a senior leader, yes, we are spending all this money on something that we all agree is flawed. Now, TV has done this sort of thing for a while and gone through things like rating points and tried to work around that. I think in digital, we have the ability to do better. And so it's worthwhile approaching these things from what the digital data allows us to do now to move from a cookie to a person, or just to understand how different channels work together instead of saying, I'm spending per channel. And same thing with the media mix going down. If we can start to understand how things have indirect effects, we start to really understand, are we spending our money in a way that helps not only my marketing, my acquisition side, but even how my current customers feel about my company. We use marketing to try to do things to make ourselves be a better brand, not just to get new customers, but to make current customers feel that the brand's a good brand to be associated with.
A lot of time. Go ahead, Sunny.
Yeah, and I just wanted to add to that. I think that we've moved from a probabilistic and modeled environment to more deterministic. And what that means is that people don't actually do what they say they're going to do, right? I mean, just because we say we're going to pick up our dry cleaning on Friday doesn't mean we're actually going to be picking up our dry cleaning on Friday. So if you include those dry cleaning purchase intenders in your cookie pool and build a programmatic buy against it, you don't necessarily know that they're going to complete the transaction at the point of sale. And so what we're trying to do is all the heavy lifting of combining the first-party data that companies and brands have entrusted us with for 45 years with the behavioral data so that we can run it and match the campaigns that have already run to see how well they've done and then build a truer picture of that attribution by looking at the offline and online sales transactions from the back ends and the data warehouse and overlaying that with the campaigns that have run. So of those who've been exposed and who have been reached with a campaign at the digital side, how many of those actually converted? And that's part of the calculation that we go through. It's really the heavy lifting. Of course, I'm waiting for John to come up with another HBS article that will provide us with the vision and the models to help simplify all that. But a lot of it is the grunt work of the data plumbing that goes on behind the scenes.
Well, what can we get a little bit more specific about that? So what you've just described is an enormous amount of work. Mm-hmm. What kind of a team are we talking about? I mean, did you have to hire 25 PhDs from Russia and fly them in and do your own custom coding? I mean, what's the deal?
We have 5,000 employees at Epsilon. A quarter of them are dedicated to online solutions, and they're certainly vertical industry experts. Yeah. But not to scare folks, but I think that Brian Anderson from Luma Partners put it very eloquently yesterday when he said that email is the connective tissue that combines consumers and apps. So without going into all of the nitty-gritty plumbing for the data joining, if we just simplify it by looking at email and conversions from email, we continue to view email as a unique identifier of people. Yep. It's a great centerpiece for multi-device attribution, because you can access it on your mobile phone as well as on your desktop. And it can be used as a trigger just across the entire consumer purchase lifecycle from acquisition, retention, loyalty.
So, John, let me ask you this. We did a study that said that only 10% of market, and I think people are exaggerating and kind of, bragging, but only 10%, let's say, of big brands are doing anything like what we're talking about here in any kind of meaningful way. You know, it's a minority. What's the resistance? Why are there, a lot of people sort of balking and dragging their feet?
I would be surprised if that's true, because I think we've seen in our company a very big pivot over the last 3 to 5 years where these sorts of analytics, these sorts of, whether it's marketing mix or attribution, I frankly think that they're both dead or they're on a death bounce. I think you can't have them as disparate solutions because people don't just live in the online world and they don't just live in the offline world. Yeah. But, and I don't mean this to sound like a commercial, but we work with 2/3 of the Fortune 50 companies, and I think there's been this big pivot from nice to have to need to have. And so I'm not sure where the data is, but in terms of the sort of
big companies,
enterprise level, and I think if you're talking about smaller companies, it's, I think to your point, I don't know how painful it is anymore, but it's not inexpensive. And so there's sort of a threshold beneath which it may or may not make economic sense.
But it's a different question, right? It's not whether companies are using this. I think every company has it on their checkbox that they need to do something like this. The question is, are they actually using this stuff to actually make decisions?
Right.
Right. Is it shelfware? Are people looking at it? Are they saying, wow, this is really interesting. Nevertheless, I'm going to spend based on this last click number here because it's easy.
Right.
And yeah, it's not enough to say that people are using this stuff. Google is going to give it away at some point. You know, you guys are going to make it easier and easier and easier. You guys are going to have probably some easy, cool way for smaller companies to get involved with all the smarts. At the same time, though, if people don't actually use the thing, it's not going to matter whether people have it or not. I think that's the big, the big question.
I would agree with that, that if you walk in with a pure technology solution without some layer of consultancy, to use a term that some of the tech companies don't like to have, but I'd say 10% of our revenues are consulting for your very reason. If you drop it as good as it is on a desk somewhere, it's going to be a science experiment. And it's, if you're making the wrong decisions, you're leaving a huge amount of money on the table.
Okay. And I think some of the best companies, or the Fortune 50, like Citi and like Kraft yesterday, have the luxury of being able to build proprietary systems that can build a key ring to connect all the data around those customers together, so that at every touch point, whether it's a call center or an email or a response to a campaign, you can start to build that account profile at the individual level to potentially enable personalization. But not every company out there has that budget or the capability. So I do think, to John's point, having the services capability as a consultancy is where mid-sized to smaller companies can come in and start to play in the game.
John, so somebody brought up Google a second ago, and let's just address this directly. So last year, on the same day, the same exact day, Google and AOL both acquired a standalone, previously standalone attribution platforms, Odometry and Convertro. My question to you, I put it to John, it's sort of like a law, but...
backstage, you said you were going to ask Sonny this question.
I'll ask Sonny this question.
No,
actually, I'll ask anybody, why did they do this, and should we be scared?
Anyone? I'm waiting for John to answer that one. Look, I think greater transparency is great for everyone. So the publishers clearly want to provide value add to be part of that media buy. They're relying on their agencies and the media planners there to kind of come up with the better mousetrap. And so I think there's going to be greater consolidation and vertical integration to provide that value.
Yeah, the question is, should it be a publisher offering that service? And so AOL and Google both play an interesting role in that they're tech providers and publisher, depending on how you loosely define those things. It's a tough sell, though, to say that I want to trust the publisher to also be the evaluator of how the media I'm selling through them is being performing. It would be nice to have a somehow independent arbiter helping with that. And not to say we're not going to use whatever the best approach out there, but it would be really nice to have folks who aren't the publisher, aren't the ad server, aren't the ad network, necessarily also being the thing helping you evaluate how the spend is played.
Right. And I would say the why is sort of, I think, sort of obvious, because the publishers ultimately would want more control and to have other people directing this close to $1 trillion of marketing that's spent around the world annually.
Sure.
Is something that everybody would like to have as much influence as possible.
I also think it implies, by the way, that everybody's going to have an attribution solution. You know, I was talking to somebody yesterday who said, we also offer attribution. I'm like, your company's no business offering attribution, because it gets so far away from all this other stuff. But it's almost like everybody who wants to be any part of the ecosystem has decided they're going to offer something that sounds like attribution. And so I worry about the commoditization of the term and what it really means to understand how you're allocating the stuff and optimizing it.
Yeah, because I think that traditionally, to the extent that this business has been around for a few years, can be traditional. Yeah. Attribution, I think, means digital attribution. And as I said, I think that's going to be dead, because people just don't live in that world. And also, by definition, the term attribution is retrospective. And I think the core of what we do and a lot of other companies in our space endeavor to do is have companies help them to make smarter decisions, whether they're at the very aggregate level or at the base level. I describe, when I'm pitching our product, is it's sort of like Google Earth. You can make, you know, global decisions. You can go down to the city level, or you can go down to the street level. And the street level is sort of the attribution, you know, plugging into a programmatic buying system and really going from, I want to sell an extra 400 vehicles in Wichita, Kansas, as a strategic decision or a business decision, and you push a button, and the analytics takes that all the way through to execution wherever you can buy programmatically. I think that, that's where the world's headed, and that's why you've got these battleships of Adobe and SAP and Salesforce and IBM and so forth and Oracle building these marketing clouds. I think that that's the way that the world's headed.
Is it now, so Google, AOL, they're media companies. They own now Attribution Solutions. Presumably they're going to be offering this as a service to measure the impact of their media. So we're not actually saying that they'll be biased. They'll be reporting the results. But what is the fear exactly? Like, why would I not just go with Google / odometry to measure the impact of my marketing spend?
There's no harm in using any of these technologies and testing them. And I'll point out that testing anything is actually kind of hard. But I'll talk about that in a moment. But at the end of the day, it can be tough when the attribution decision makes a recommendation that's so unlike what you've done before. It said you should chop down all this stuff you've been doing over the last 20 years, quit doing all this stuff, and do it totally differently. And then you're like, well, that's funny, because it's what it's saying to do totally differently seems to be spend more with, coincidentally, the publishing partner that is offering this attribution solution. And they would say, no, it's separation of church and state, Chinese wall, pick your metaphor. That being said, it's just hard to convince people who are used to doing things a certain way to change when there's all these potential biases that come in. It may be the best solution in the world, but there are lots of people looking for an excuse to not do this, because it's a lot of work, it's a lot of effort, and there are a lot of costs. So when you have easy sort of ways to stop somebody from taking an action, why do that? So that's why I'm saying it's worthwhile testing these things. I would like to have the flexibility to choose things that are associated with my publishers, better data, better flow through, things not associated with my publishers. They can be a little independent.
I think the important thing is transparency. So if these solutions that are sitting with publishers are really transparent, so that people, I think most major marketers have their PhDs who can come in and take a look and see whether or not these are unbiased, that I don't see a lot of harm, other than I want to keep coming back to this theme, is the world of attribution really, I think, grew up around this concept of DR. Mm. And while that's great and you should leverage the data, people, we have an auto client, and they came to me once and said that they were pitched by some vendor around making real-time decisions, and they said, can you do that for us? And I said, absolutely, and there's certain decisions that you want to be in real-time. You want to be able to serve up the right ad to the right person at the right time. But when was the last time you saw someone buy a car based upon that, you know, that one last thing? It doesn't happen that way, and there are very few purchases that go down there. So it really is making the right decision at the right time, right message, right person. So it's sort of a confluence of these different areas.
Okay. And I think there's a fear in trusting the calculation from a single model. So what Facebook and Google have done are tremendous. If you're in the FBX or if you're on Gmail with an Android phone and using Google. So unless your media plan's 100% Google or 100% Facebook, how do you know that you can actually accommodate for all the other media partners that are part of your plan? So,
and I have heard from our agents, from agencies, including ours, that they don't always like to share the entire media plan with any one publisher.
Right.
So there are certainly lead publishers who see a lot of it, but the feeling is that, you know, keeping the entire story close to vest may be beneficial. If your attribution provider also happens to be the publisher, you are giving them the entire media buy. It's, you know, in today's world, it's not such a big deal, I guess, compared to what it used to be, but we do hear that as a concern.
I think if you really zoom out, you know, why does any of this matter?
Yeah.
And, you know, there's the old saying, half my marketing works and half doesn't, and I just don't know which half, and at least I'm sort of paraphrasing it. And if there's a $1 trillion, that means $500 billion, give or take, around the world is wasted. Think about what you could do with that, whether it's getting plowed into innovation or to shareholders or reduced prices to consumers. There's a lot. Our clients touch about $60 billion of ad spend a year, so it's 8 or 9% of the global market. We tend to find that the inefficiencies are between 20 and 40%, so it's not quite the 50. That's a lot of money. So I mean, I think the why this matters is really taking the inefficiency out of the good work that everybody does here and benefiting the whole ecosystem.
Okay. Well, part of it, we talk about success metrics. So when you're building a model, you need something to be measuring. What are you impacting? It's DR, I mean, it's sales or it's online sales. But in the brand world, you're trying to influence someone's perception. It's sort of, how do I feel about this brand? How can attribution marketing mix modeling take account of that side of the picture, which is the kind of the softer side of marketing, which is nonetheless very important? Sonny, is there any way?
Well, obviously you can track action. So if someone is, so we have a lot of automotive dealers, and I think that the last time someone actually clicked a banner to buy a car, you know, I'd like to know. But, you know, so when you're going down the purchase funnel for a highly intensive capital product or even for a longer lead sales, like for a mortgage, for example, there are numerous steps along the way that you can capture and observe. So is someone doing a dealer locator? That's an opportunity to measure brand sentiment. Are they doing one of those car configurators where you can choose the leather interior and the wheels and so on and so forth? So those are all actions that are observable that you can track and capture, and certainly that's one way to measure brand sentiment beyond the, you know, click and the purchase when you roll out the drive, the dealer.
Different, slightly different point of view. Brand should be measured the way that the marketers are comped on it. So, unfortunately,
or
enough,
they need to change the comp.
That's the way they think about it. So, if it's, you can do look at brand in one of two ways. It's an indirect predictor of direct response in sales. So, the media mix model, the attribution models, everything like view through and upper funnel, mid funnel behaviors, engagement behaviors, those are all predictors that go in and show that there's something to be attributed to brand. The other option is to model your behavior being some shift in brand, affect, recall. Like, and all those pieces, and do the attribution modeling that way. Which of my ad and channels and creative and approaches are driving through a sequence some action in someone's mental perception? Hard to do, and you'll find that most of the people who want to do attribution are going to say, well, no, we're going to predict sales. Why would we predict this fluffy brand stuff? But it's worthwhile considering that there is a lot of value to brand outside and beyond sales, especially above acquisition. And so we've been experimenting with both ways to understand how do we figure out what brand impact seems to be in a sales cycle, as well as how do you predict what brand impact is on its own multifaceted experience.
Yeah. So what is Citi today actually doing with attribution media mix modeling?
So we use media mix modeling to measure our media across multi-channels. We actually do use MarketShare partners. Okay. We also have experimented with a variety of attribution providers. We've used things that we built ourselves. We use things from our friends at Adobe, things from the cool folks at Adometry, things from a litany. And running down the list, you start to discover there are a lot of people offering attribution solutions and services. And one of the struggles, and you have one too. Hey, I got one. So one of the struggles is all of these things, so it's a bit frustrating. They give slightly different answers. They are able to answer different types of questions. Sometimes the questions we ask of them aren't necessarily phrased in a way that allows us to get an answer out of it. And when it goes against the gut, goes against the belief of some of our marketers, it can be tough to convince them that this completely different experience that they're talking about here is the right way to go. And it leads me to testing, which is something this industry is going to have to figure out. It is exceedingly difficult to test the recommendation of these solutions, especially when a solution might say to a media partner, you probably should spend less of this media partner. Well, the moment that IO comes through, media partner picked up the phone and says, hey, you know, we've been doing business with you guys for 100 years. So why are you pulling the buyout? And we say, well, the attribution solution said it wasn't working for us. And, you know, it's tough to test these things. Also tough to do a true A-B controlled test, especially when you have offline media in the mix. I'm not saying we're going to solve it here, but that's really going to be the big breaker. You either have to take this stuff completely on faith and say, thank you, Google or MarketShare or whatever. I believe you without doing any testing. I will change my media budget. Or we had to find a way to enable testing in this across multiple channels and understand what real impact shifts in media have on consumer behavior. And the attribution solution by itself is not enough.
We run tests, but I think really importantly, and this is a good and bad thing, is what we do is very naked. We say, 3 months from now, this is what the world's going to look like. Yeah. And so you're either right or wrong. So maybe you don't make the step function change in behavior a tool might recommend, but if you do the sort of half step and the simulation engine, because this is all about predictive analytics, says this is what's going to happen. If it doesn't, you know.
But by that point, it's too late. I don't know what to change to go back to where I was, and now I'm off my forecast from my sales team, who then said we were going to sell this many credit cards or mortgages or bank accounts, and now due to this media change, we're way in the hole. What can you fix to change it? If the attribution model didn't work, I can't say, oh, well, we're going to use the attribution model. So having the way to be able to test and understand what parts of it seem to be forecasting correctly while still being able to keep my control group, my last click, terrible idea I know, but last click, or something in place, it would be really helpful. And it's going to require some technological improvement in the way ads are served. It's going to require some changes in the way offline things are happening. So the programmatic media within TV, for example, might allow us to do a different type of split testing than we've ever been able to do in the past. But without some of these testing, just taking on faith is hard.
So correlation is not causation, basically.
You can test for it. You can prove causation.
So I have a to get very practical, John. So if I buy the argument and I'm like, all right, I really want to know how my marketing is doing, and I'm willing to go with your solution, market share, give you $1 million or whatever. What do you do exactly? What do you do exactly? Like, what's the next step?
Well,
do I have to? Give you data, presumably.
Well, there's a series of steps. One is you get a series of stakeholders around the table. First, because if you don't get buy-in at the beginning, as I said before, you become a science experiment. We have a meeting where we ask people, tell us everything that you think affects people, and whether it's B2B or B2C, to make a decision to buy your product or service. And my belief is that good marketers could put things into three buckets. It really works, it kind of works, or it doesn't work, but with the analytics you're able to really get it much more precise. Then we identify the data that represents each of those different drivers. We've spent a huge amount of time over the last few years making direct data relationships to unburden our customers as much as possible. So only really unique streams like sales. Well, even in the auto industry, J.D. Power has better sales data than our clients. But you collect the data, validate the data, build them into a model. So this is the sort of the thin labor piece at the front end. And it's not painless. It could be anywhere between a few weeks and a couple of months. And then once you have that up and running, you load it in a tool, and then you get, it's sort of like a GPS system in your car. You can go ahead, you know, what's the most efficient way to get from here to here, or here to here to here, and then you go ahead and make decisions based on that. Okay. Where our solutions now go is for programmatic buying, you could actually flow straight through into the media maths or rocket fuels of the world and go straight through without any, if you want, any human intervention at all. People tend to want to have that check at various stages, but that's what we do.
Okay. Now, in terms of the future, we talked about, somebody mentioned Google and Google Analytics. Google essentially gives away web analytics for free as a loss leader or whatever. Is it possible that attribution will become a commodity that's sort of freely available by somebody? And is that, first of all, is it possible? And second of all, is it desirable? Sunny?
I think Google's a leader, certainly. So if they're able to be a loss leader and provide some benchmarks for attribution, I think that's always a good thing. But putting it into practice with multivariate testing is probably where the rubber hits the road. Yeah. So I don't think it'll be customized, because in the practical nuts and bolts of actually testing attribution, you've got to find those segments and put together tactics, media tactics against them, and then see if it translates to dollars in the cash register. Yeah.
But I guess the question for me is, if you're talking about attribution, what are you trying to drive? Because if you don't have the outcomes data, you know, an outcome might be an intermediate. Did I click here or do I go there? But if you're saying, did I sell something in a retail location or did I sell something online, I don't think companies like Google are going to be able to get most of that data anyway.
Offline sales data.
Sales data, global marketing spend, offline marketing spend. So I don't think that you will be able to get point solutions that can help give you directional understanding is sort of in a vacuum, and again in a DR sort of oriented way. But imagine doing an online campaign in one environment where you've got a TV campaign supporting you, and that same online campaign without TV. You're going to get wildly different results. Or if the competition cuts their price in half, that's going to have such a profound impact on your online interaction with your consumer. But the attribution players, that's why I think they're dead in terms of where the world's headed. You have to look at the way people interact with brands and interact with media, because it comports with gut. And if you don't, you'll get wrong answers. The question is, how wrong?
So I disagree, and I think that every one of the providers, not to agree with all of it, but I'll say that every one of the providers, any of the folks who are in this room, I suspect, in the back of their head are thinking through some type of attribution service you're going to include in your product. Yeah. I think every major leading DMP-DSP combo, every major ad campaign networks, every campaign management system, they're all going to have attribution technology. There are startups out there now that are simply API-driven odometries, in effect. They are attribution systems that have an API, you feed them a bunch of data, they spit out an analysis. And whether those are the right answers, whether they're useful, whether you have all the data in them, that's sort of beside the question for the moment. The question of, will this stuff be available for free or included with things you're already buying? Yes. Will it have access to all the right data? Maybe, maybe not. Will it answer the right question? Maybe, maybe not. And that's why I think it's going to get confusing. For Route 15, we're going to see each and every vendor we work with offering some type of attribution solution. Some are going to do the link to offline things. Some are going to feed in from television media plan and pull that in and say, you ran this spot at this point and this point. We'll look at responses during that point. We don't have to track the TV. Some will use OTT and actually, you know, do the programmatic and search, but many will pull this up together. We're seeing tons of companies come to us and say, well, we're throwing it in. You buy our stuff, you just get this for free. But the thing to know is it's impossible for us to spread our data all to all these companies. Yeah. And it is going to be tough for the company to get all the data. So I think some are going to rise up to be the industry leaders, but it's going to get messy for a while. So it's just something to consider. If you're entering the space, recognize that it's going to be a lot of people all saying they could do the same thing, just like with DSPs a few years ago. And same for the client. It's going to get more confusing for a while for us to decide to spend on things. And saying, yeah, you get it for free, like tag management and all the rest of it, right, may not be enough to make a sale.
And I think that's where the challenge is, too, is that organizations are very siloed. So that's where the collision exists. The media buying teams are not necessarily using the same KPIs for their success metrics as the marketing mixed model folks who are looking for new audiences to discover. So if they don't agree or have a handshake on that KPI, then you're not necessarily building that omni-channel picture.
Totally, totally agree. And I don't think we're that far apart. I mean, I do think it is going to be ubiquitous, but I think in terms of making smart decisions, it just doesn't comport with the way the world actually works. So,
sure. So there's actually a pretty funny paper that came out from, a lot of the original work in the space was done by the Atlas Institute, which was owned by Microsoft and now owned by Facebook, and last year they put out something called Measuring Business Value Beyond the Last Click, I think it was. And they quoted in their eBay saying that they'd done an attribution exercise, and it turns out that paid search didn't work as well as they thought. So it seemed like Facebook using eBay as ammunition in the war against Google. It gets layers on layers here, wheels on wheels. But my point here is that every attribution exercise that I personally have been through and witnessed, the end result is that it says, take a little money out of paid search and put it into display. And I'm being kind of simplistic here, but that's sort of what it says. If it's as easy as that...
Why do you need it?
Michael, I'll just throw this to you first. Can I just kind of do that adjustment ahead of time and save myself the hassle?
No, there's a great tool called Excel we've been using. It's amazing. It doesn't always say that. So to be fair, it does go through different things. What you struggle with is it'll say it for certain groups and not for others. And then you start saying, all right, now for this segment, I got to do it this way, and this segment, I got to do it this way. And then you say, all right, it says to shift it to display, and you say, all right, which media partners, which creative types, which types of targeting? And then as you start getting into the different types of detail that your planner's going to say, well, I don't want some machine telling me this, but I'm willing to take guidance, we start to struggle with the ability of these tools and software and services to get to that level of granularity. At which point the media planner says, well, you're not going to tell me, I'll do what I always do, I'll figure it out. And so you do have the struggle that the tools don't necessarily tell you the level of detail you might want from them to answer some of these questions. Yeah. And B, while it isn't always sending to display, I will say that the joke in the that goes around the round at times is attribution is a fancy word for saying, how do I shift more money to display? And that is, you know, it's pulled across that way, especially because it's mostly display folks pitching it. But you know, we've often seen the...
Display works.
Yeah, you know, we swear to God, this view-through thing, it's real. It is, and there's certainly something there. Yeah. We've seen attribution go both ways, though, and so it all depends on the segment and the buying cycle and the customer journey. I will say, though, that in cases where it says to wholeheartedly throw lots of money out of something that is so demonstrably important to the last click, that can be a tough sell to a senior marketing lead.
And I think what Facebook has done is really great in the multi-device attribution. I think that they just announced that they're looping together interest in Super Bowl. So
it's the big game.
Right, for the big game. And so you can start to harvest opportunities for sponsorship in display within Facebook. Mm. But that type of platform is not necessarily the best place for all types of context. So we have a lot of healthcare companies on our client roster, and I don't think that you would go on Facebook to say that you've just been diagnosed with type 2 diabetes or some other chronic care, right?
Some people do.
Some people do. I guess if you want to build that community of support and caregiving, certainly. But certainly there are other conditions that you don't necessarily want to disclose, and that's where some of the personal databases that we have access to can be helpful for privacy-related issues. So it really depends on the context of the client. Outreach.
If I'm a marketer and then I have, my DMP, my DSP, I have my web analytics provider, everyone's telling me they have an attribution solution and, try this, try that. And how do I evaluate these things? I mean, how do I know what questions to ask? Is it a coin toss? Is it my friend? I guess I'll ask John this question.
We have a marketer here, so I can give
all
two
right.
Cents,
well, Michael, whoever.
It's tough, man. It's the old days of going down the checklist is everybody's got all the same checklist stuff.
Yeah,
and then they
right.
say, well, test us against what you're doing now and compare the outcome. Well, it's a lot of work to get that data out there. The Lord love it. The way insertion orders and marketing things are designed are great for billability. They suck for analytics. And so when you try and get this data out of a system that has been your campaign management system and turn it into something you can analyze, it's a lot of work. And it had to be slightly different for each of these providers. And so I wish I had a better answer other than it's a lot of work to test these things. And it's partially that inertia that makes it hard to switch. You don't see a lot of folks switching from piece to piece. Like you might try a different publishing partner or media partner either. You put them on the plan this week, you drop them next week. But for attribution, it's so much work to get it embedded in there and to follow your business. It's so much work to change it. It's actually kind of tough. Plus, these things take time to work through. I would say, though, that folks who have some experience with the vertical industry that you're in, that's really powerful. The customer journeys and the business that we face in healthcare for some of your clients or for Fin Services for us, there's a lot of things that are similar to every other business. You're selling stuff, right? But at the same time, there's legal constraints, regulatory constraints, requirements on the type of ad we sell, how we buy, all sorts of other attributes that if your folks understand that, it makes the models work a lot better. They give predictions that make a lot more sense. So things like that, the ability to show differentiation like that can be really helpful to allowing somebody to make the right decision to choose your solution over something else.
And to your point, that's why when you asked how we kick off, it's sitting around the table with people who understand the business. But the human brain can't take terabytes of data and give precise, reasonably precise forecasts. But again, what we see is because our, and I'm not just us, but other companies in our place, it's predictive analytics.
Yeah.
So how do you know if it's working? Well, if the software predicts that, this is what the state of the world 3 months from now, and it's within 0.5% or something, it's probably not an accident. And that I think that those are the sorts of things that encourage our clients to go ahead and start taking those baby steps in market and doing tests. But
Well, you guys have been great. We're running short of time here, so I just wanted to give you each of you a chance. Just take a less than a minute, actually, and give your prediction for 2015, the state of attribution marketing mix modeling. Anything you think will happen or you'd like to see happen, and you can mention standards or anything. We'll start with Sunny, 2015.
I think there's going to be a rise of data plumbing and a rise of data plumbing tools that will democratize the ability to visualize that data so that non-data scientists can actually start to get into those raw log files and start to examine things, because not everyone's a SQL coder.
And I think we're going to see this line between media mix and attribution fading away. Every attribution provider will get access to econometric data and to your spend data and try to put it into the system to match your TV flighting schedule and match your print schedule and do it by DMA or Zip or whatever other thing you're able to do it by. I think you're also going to see some democratization from that. You're also going to see a rise of smaller providers coming up with new and really unexpected ways of linking data together that allows you to not only look at things at a person level, but really answer some of the tougher marketing questions, looking at things that change over time and shift in state. With the rise of DMPs and the ability to look at how people shift from group and group to segment, you have a very unique view into how the marketing journey and channel works. We haven't really begun to tap yet, and I think 15 is going to be the first time that the really big data players are starting to turn their attention to this, and we'll start seeing what comes out of that. It'll be really interesting.
I'd say two things. One is the name of this panel is Colliding Worlds of Attribution and Marketing Mix, but I think a third area is colliding with that, which is CRM. Frankly, that's what our analytics do, is it pulls together these three very powerful worlds, but each have their strengths and weaknesses into a single framework. And the other, we've seen a lot of consolidation in the space with the marketing clouds, and I think that that's going to continue to accelerate. I think that there can't be 20 marketing clouds out there. I think that you'll wind up with maybe three.
What's that? You'll wind up with rain.
Right, exactly, with rain. And so that's what I think.
Great, thank you. And then my prediction is that even though this is very complex, and we tried to get a flavor of that over, that it's well worth doing, and that every one of you will be engaging in some sort of attribution marketing mix modeling exercise this year. So thank you, panelists, and thank you all for listening.
Thank you.
Sunny, thank you. Michael, pleasure. Marty,
John.
Thank you. John?
Thanks very much.
Appreciate it. All right, great. So we've come to the break. I want to remind you that left and right, as you go out into